क्वांटिटी, चार्ज इज नॉट अ फिजिकल क्वांटिटी। ओके, नाउ अनदर क्वेश्चन अराइजेस, व्हाट इज द स्मॉलेस्ट पॉसिबल चार्ज? सो स्मॉलेस्ट पॉसिबल चार्ज ऑन एन ऑब्जेक्ट इज बेसिकली चार्ज ऑफ एन इलेक्ट्रॉन और प्रोटॉन। ओके, स्मॉलेस्ट पॉसिबल चार्ज smallest possible charge is the charge of an electron slash proton. Now be very clear that magnitude of charge on proton or electron is equal, and that is 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. Okay, but charge is of two types. One type of charge is called positive charge, and automatically the other type of charge becomes negative charge. Okay,
so in the dimensions, what is A?
Is ampere.
Okay, sir.
Okay, that has been taught in very first chapter of 11th fundamental physical quantities. Okay, hello.
Yes sir.
That fundamental physical quantities are being taught in very first chapter of 11th physical world. Okay, revise that chapter after the class. Say yes sir.
Yes, sir.
Good. Charge is of two types. Number one, positive charge. And number two, negative charge. Okay. Now, just by convention, charge which is of type of proton is considered as positive charge. It is just by convention. There is no law behind it, no logic behind it. It is just by convention. So by convention, charge on proton is treated as positive charge, and charge on electron is treated as negative charge. Okay, remember this: charge on proton is treated as positive, whereas charge on electron is treated as negative, and this is just by convention. Okay, now charge of proton is plus 1.6 into 10 to the power minus, remember this. Okay, and charge on electron is equal to minus 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 90 coulomb. Okay, remember these two values. All right. Okay, now let us move further about properties of charge. So what are the properties of charge? So point number one, charge is of two types. Charge is of two types. Number A, positive, B, negative. Okay. So wherever you are finding the charge, you can find only two types of charges. One type is of type of proton and another type is type of electron. So those substances which have charge of the type of proton are called as positively charged, and those substances which have charge of the type of electron are considered as or called as negatively charged. Okay. So charge is of two types, positive, negative. Next point. Like charges repel, unlike charges attract. Like charges repel, unlike charges attract. Okay. So whenever same type of charges are there, there will be repulsion. Like means same type. And whenever there are opposite type of charges are there, then there will be attraction. Okay. If you have positive, then there will be repulsion. If you have negative charge, then there will be repulsion. Okay. But if there is one positive and one negative, then there is attraction. Okay. If there is one positive, one negative, then there will be attraction. Okay. Good. So like charges repel, unlike charges attract. Next point. Charge is quantized. Charge is quantized. Now what is meaning of this statement? This statement says that first of all, the minimum possible charge which is freely available is charge on an electron or proton. Okay. There are two parts in this. Minimum possible independently available charge. Independent available charge is charge on electron or proton. Okay. Minimum possible independently available charge is charge on electron or proton. This is point number one. Second thing in this is that charge which is available on any object. Charge available on any object will be integral multiple of charge and electron. Okay. So whichever charge is available in universe on any object, that charge will be some integral multiple of charge of electron. So Q is equal to plus minus ne. Q is equal to plus minus ne. What is Q here? Q is charge on any object. Charge on any object. What is E here? E is charge on electron. And what is N here? N is integer. N is integer. Okay. Now try to understand the meaning of this statement, exact meaning. That suppose if you find charge on any electron, so that charge will be either 1 electron or 2 electron or 3 or 4, 5, 6, 8, 10, 20, 100, 200, 500. Such will be the scenario. Charge on any object will be some number into charge of 1 electron. You cannot find charge on any substance as, let's say, E by 2. Okay. E by 2 charge is not possible. E by 2 is not possible. 1.25 E not possible. 3.75 E not possible. 5.1 E not possible. Are you getting it? These values of charges are not possible. Charge will always be integral multiple of charge of electron. Okay. Now let me give you one question based on this. Question. Which of the following charge is not possible? Which of the following charge is not possible? A 3.2 into 10 to the power minus 19. B 6.4 into 10 to the power minus 18. These are all coulombs. C 4.8 into 10 to the power minus 19. And D 6.4 into 10 to the power minus 20 coulomb.
Please tell me that out of these four, which is not possible? डेविस इज सेइंग डी, आराधे सेइंग डी, दिशा डी, मधुरा डी, लिजा डी, प्रतीक्षा डी, यश इज सेइंग बी एंड डी इज नॉट पॉसिबल, वेरी नाइस. श्रीजा इज सेइंग डी, ऋषिकेश इज सेइंग डी, स्पृहा डी, सनिका डी, संजना, ईशान, चिन्मयी, ऑल दीज पीपल आर सेइंग डी. बी एंड डी, लेट मी. ओके, सो इफ आई चेक 3.2 into 10 to the power minus 19. So that comes out to be 2 into 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19, which is possible because that is in format of any. That is possible. Now let me check 6.4 into 10 to the power minus 18. So that can be written as 4. Into 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 into 10, because 10 to the power minus 19 into 10 will be 10 to the power minus 18, which is in the format of NE. So it is possible. Are you paying attention, Yash? Next comes C part. Wait, Johan, C part, 4.8 into 10 to the power minus 19. So that is 3 into 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19, which is also of the format any type, and hence it is correct. When we see D part, that is 6.4 into 10 to the power minus 20. If you notice closely, that is lesser than the charge of one electron. This value is lesser than, because it is 10 to the power minus 20, mind it, lesser than charge of electron. So if value is lesser than charge of electron, will it be possible? No. So which of the following is not possible? D part. 6.4 in minus 20 cannot be freely or independently available. Okay. Johan understood. Yes, you understood. Yash. Yash is not responding. So this is about charge being quantized. Okay. If you want to understand quantization of charge in a simple way, then I can explain you in a different manner. If you see in it, the minimum value of currency which is applicable, which if you go to bank and try to use, then they have to accept is 50 paisa. Okay, though shopkeepers are not accepting it, but banks, if you take 50 paisa coin, then they have to accept, because as of now in India 50 paisa is working, government has not withdrawn it. So 50 paisa can be called as quantum of money in India. Please pay attention to the word quantum. Okay. 50 paisa is the smallest possible value of money which has some value. Which has some value means which will be accepted by the banks. Now, what is importance of 50 paisa being a quantum of money in India? Suppose if you have 1 rupee in your pocket, that means you have 250 paisa. If you have 5 rupees in your pocket, that means you have 1050 paisa. If someone has 100 rupees, that means that fellow has 250 paisa. Okay? So 50 paisa is the quantum of money in India presently. Similarly, charge on one electron is the smallest possible quantum. There cannot be anything which has charge lesser than 50 paisa. And charge 50 paisa means charge of one electron. And wherever you are finding any value of charge, that charge will be integral multiple of charge of one electron or two or three, five, 10, 20, 100, 200, 500, 1000, 10,000, 50,000, like that. Okay. If you are somebody saying that charge of 50.1 electron, sorry, that's not possible. Okay. So that is the meaning of quantization of charge. Okay. So this was the other property of charge, that charge is quantized. Next property of charge is charge is relativistically invariant. Okay, next property is charge is relativistically invariant. Now you might have heard this word for the first time. Charge is relativistically invariant. Okay. What is meaning of this statement, or what is meaning of this sentence? So try to understand. If you talk about other fundamental physical quantities like mass, length, okay. So mass of an object m is equal to m naught upon under the root of 1 minus v square upon c square. What does it mean? That if m naught is the rest mass of an object, and if that object starts moving with velocity v, then mass of the object changes, and changes according to the formula which I have written here. Okay. Similarly, if you talk about length of an object, L naught 1 minus v square upon g square. So length of an object also changes if the object starts moving. If the object starts moving. Okay. So basically mass and length. Yeah, I am repeating also, and I am giving you definition also. So basically mass and length of an object do not remain constant if object starts moving. Okay. Mass and length of an object do not remain constant. Do not remain constant and change with speed of object. Okay. How you can say with speed? Because the factor of v square is there. V square is there. What is c here? Here c is speed of light. Here c is speed of light. Okay. Why don't we observe this thing in our day-to-day life? Because objects which are moving, they are moving with very slow speed. 10 meter per second, 20 meter per second, 30 meter per second, like that. And speed of light is very fast. It is 3 lakh kilometer per second. So 10, 20, 30 meter per second as compared to 3 lakh kilometer per second is very small, or you can say negligible value. So that's why we don't observe this phenomena in our day-to-day life. But if something starts moving with speed comparable to speed of light, then this formula, this fact considerable, then we cannot neglect it, then we cannot ignore it. Okay. So basic thing is mass and length of an object do not remain constant, and change with speed of object. Okay. Charge of an object does not depend on speed of object or frame of reference. Speed of object or frame of reference. So basically, whether the charge is at rest or moving slowly or moving faster or moving with speed comparable to speed of light, in all the cases, value of charge does not change. Okay. Hence, value of charge remains fixed or unchanged irrespective of speed of object. That's why charge is called as relativistically invariant. So charge does not depend on speed of object or speed of frame of reference. Okay, its value remains fixed. So that's why it is called as charge being relativistically invariant. So what does it mean? You won't be finding any formula like Q is equal to Q naught upon under root of V square minus E. Okay, such things will not be available for charge. All right. Okay, good. So this is the meaning of charge being relativistically invariant. Okay. Next comes charge is conserved. Next property. Charge is conserved. In fact, if you remember the first chapter of 11th physical world, it says that conservation of charge is amongst the four fundamental. Okay. Which other conservation laws were there? Conservation of charge, conservation of energy, conservation of linear momentum, and conservation of angular momentum. These were the four fundamental conservation laws of physics. Okay, which we have studied in 11th standard also. What is meaning of charge being conserved? Pay attention. Suppose you have NaCl. Okay. You have NaCl. Now, that is NaCl being a compound, it is electrically neutral. NaCl is electrically neutral. Now, what you did, you kept this, you dipped this in water, and due to that, what has happened? Na has become Na plus and Cl minus has become Cl minus. Now the bond has been broken. Bond has been broken and you have got Na plus and Cl minus. Now due to that, if you see, when NaCl is broken, one Na plus and one Cl minus is created. How much was the charge initially before Na and Cl are broken? It was zero. How much is the charge later now? Even now it is zero because Na plus and plus Cl minus become zero. Okay. So basically what we have observed that even chemical total charge of system is remaining the same and that is zero. And that's what the charge conservation law says. charge conservation law says that the total charge of the universe is constant or conserved or unchanged. So total charge of the universe, total charge of the universe remains constant slash unchanged slash conserved. Okay. These three words, constant, unchanged, and conserved, can be used alternatively, one in place of another. Okay. So this law is called as law of conservation of charge. This is called as law of conservation of charge. This law is called as law of conservation of charge. Okay. It is the fundamental conservation law. It is the fundamental basic conservation laws. In physics. Okay. Any doubt, any questions so far, anyone? Is there any doubt, any question? Please feel free to ask if you have. No doubt? All right. So after properties of charge, now we are going to talk about methods of charging. What do you mean by methods of charging? That means how we can give charge to an object, okay, or any of charge. So methods of charging. Methods of charging. Basically, there are many methods of charging, but some methods are prominent. So there are three prominent methods of charging. There are three prominent methods of charging. Number one, charging by friction. Number two, charging by induction. And number three, charging by conduction. Okay. So these are the three ways of charging of any object. All right. So let us talk about these three in detail. So number one, charging by friction. Charging by friction. So what is charging by friction? Try to understand. Suppose we have two substances. One is this rod and one is this rod. Let me use a different color. Okay. This is, let me call this as rod A and this as rod B. Now if you are rubbing rod A and B, okay, so when two substances are rubbed with each other, in the process of rubbing, heat is produced due to friction. Heat is produced due to friction. Now due to that heat,
which is produced in the process of friction, some loosely bonded electron of one substance get transferred into another substance. Okay. Now the substance from which electrons are going, that substance will have lack of electrons. So lack of electron means positively charged. And the substance in which electrons are going, that substance will have excess of electrons. That means excess of negative charge. And that substance will be negatively charged. That substance will be negatively charged. So let us talk about it. So when two substances, when two substances are rubbed with each other, heat is produced. Heat is produced due to friction. Due to friction. Okay. Due to this heat, loosely bound electron from one substance get transferred to another substance. Loosely bounded electrons from one substance get transferred to another substance. Full stop. The substance from which electrons are going, becomes positively charged. And the substance in which electrons are going becomes negatively charged. Okay, so the substance from which electrons are going, once again I am telling you, as electrons have gone, negative charge has gone, so that substance becomes positively charged. And the substance in which electrons are going, so basically in that substance negative charge is going, so that substance becomes negatively charged. Okay. In this process, let me tell you, mass of electron is very, very, very less. Mass of one electron is 9.1 into 10 to the power minus 31 kg. Okay. So change of mass is negligible. But in terms of physics, if someone asks that what will be the effect on mass, then obviously the substance which is becoming positively charged, that will have lesser mass, and the substance which is getting negative charge, that will be getting more. Okay. Any question in this? Please feel free to ask any questions if you find.
So could you please repeat the point that you just made?
What I am saying is the substance which is losing electrons. Okay. So as electrons have gone, mass has gone. So that substance will be lighter. Okay. And the substance in which electrons are going, that substance is getting mass. So that substance will become heavier. Are you getting it?
Yes, sir.
So that is the point actually. Okay. The substance which get the electron becomes negatively charged and heavier, and the substance which loses the electrons becomes positively charged and because mass is okay. So this is the phenomena of charging by friction. Now remember one thing, by this method, by charging by friction, we cannot give too much charge to an object. Why? Because once a substance will become positively charged, it will become very difficult to remove extra electrons from it. Okay. So by this method of charging by friction, by this method of charging by friction, too much charge cannot be given to an object. Okay. Again, the reason is that, yeah, please.
So could you please explain again why it can't take too much charge? We can't give too much charge.
You tell me, initially you had 100 rupees, okay? And I had 100 rupees. Now, after that, I took 50 rupees from you. Now you have only 50 rupees and I have got 150 rupees. Okay. And now I am coming again to you to ask the money. You will say, already you have 150 rupees. I have only 50 rupees. I am not going to give you any more. Are you getting it? So any yes. substance which has already become positively charged, and now you are going again to it to ask, ki, give me some electrons so that you can become more positively charged. It will say, no. I am already positive charged. I am not going to give you any further electrons. Okay. It yes, is sir. Easier to get electrons from a neutral object than from a positively charged object. Understood?
Yes.
If a person is already hungry, you cannot take food from the person. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is charging by friction. Next comes charging by induction. Pay attention to that. Charging by induction. Charging by induction. Charging by induction means, suppose you are sitting in a class in which you are not interested in studying. Okay. There is a class of 50 students and you are not interested in studying, but 40 students are interested in studying. So out of 50, 40 are very keen and 10 are not so keen in studying. Okay. Now when those 40 students which are there in the class who are very keen about their study, when they keep on asking doubts, when they keep on solving questions, remaining 10, those who are not so keen about study, they will also feel that these students are just like us and they are studying, they are paying so much attention, they are asking questions. And due to those presence of 40 students, those 10 students also start paying attention to what is being taught. So this is learning by induction. This is learning by induction. Okay. Now let us talk about charging. So suppose one charge object is there. Okay, let me show it to you. Suppose this is a metal. Now, a metal basically is electrically neutral. All right. So when metal is electrically neutral, now what you did, you brought a rod which is positively charged. So when this rod is positively charged, so what will happen due to this? Due to this positively charged, the negative charge which is there on the metal, it will come closer to the rod. It will come closer to the rod. So when the negative charge is coming closer to the rod, the positive charge which was already there, that will also be there. So what is happening? Delocalization of charge is happening due to presence of this rod. Presence of rod is causing, presence of rod is causing delocalization. Delocalization of charge, delocalization of charge on metallic sphere. Okay, so now if I ask you question, why the delocalization of charge is happening on metallic sphere, then you are going to say, sir, it is due to the presence of charged rod. Presence of charged rod. Your answer is correct. So when this phenomena is happening due to the presence of something else, what is something else here? That something else is rod. So as the rod is causing, the delocalization of charge, this type of charging is called charging by induction. It is induced by the presence of some other object, some other charge. Okay, so what is induction basically? Try to understand the phenomena of induction. Okay, yes.
So the rod does not come in contact with the object, right?
No.
Okay, so thank you.
If rod comes in contact, that will become charging by conduction. Okay. As of now, there is no contact. Okay. Okay. So now understand the phenomena of induction. What exactly is induction? So appearance of charge. Appearance of charge on one object, appearance of charge on one object due to the presence of, due to the presence of charge on another object, due to the presence of charge on another object is called charging by induction. Understood. So the appearance of charge on the metallic sphere due to the presence of charged rod will be called charging by induction of metallic sphere. Now Tej is asking a question. Sir, if the rod is neutral, there will be no change, right? Tej, you tell me, if a student comes in your class who is not saying anything, neither participating in learning nor giving any comments, he is just sitting, or you can say if I put a teddy bear, are you going to get inspired by a teddy bear to study more? Tej, answer my question first. If I put a teddy bear in your class, will you get inspired to study more by the teddy bear? No. Correct? Because that is not causing any induction. Right? So here, if you are putting a neutral rod, as you are writing in the question, that neutral rod has no. So how is it going to get induce any charge on the metallic sphere? It will not cause any induction. Understood?
So no, sir, I was asking if the rod is neutral, then both will remain neutral, right?
Obviously, then there will be no induction. That's what I have already answered. Understood? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Understood? Understood, Tej? So, can everyone read the definition which we have written? Appearance of charge on one object due to the presence of charge on another object is called charging by induction. So if there is no charge on another object, this won't be induction. All right. Now, you can ask another question. Sir, what if we remove this rod from here? If you remove the rod from here, then the metallic sphere will become as it is, as it was earlier. Okay. So basically, charging by induction can be temporary also, and it can be permanent also. So charging by induction, please note everyone, charging by induction can be temporary also. Or it can be permanent also. Now you might ask, sir, how it can be permanent? So as I told you, if you remove this rod right now, then the metallic sphere will become as it is. And as the metallic sphere is becoming as it is, then there is no induction happening if you remove the rod. But if you cut the metallic sphere while the rod is present, okay? If you have cut the metallic sphere while the rod is present, and after that if you remove the rod, then one part of the sphere will have permanently negative charge and one part of the sphere will have permanently positive charge. And that way, charging through induction will be permanent. That way, charging through induction will be permanent. All right. Any doubt, any question about this? Any doubt, any question about this? How charging can be.
So, you mean
the. And how charging can be temporary by induction?
So, you mean negative charges will just shift towards the side where the rod is there and just remain over there?
Yes, yes. Because now you have cut the path, no? Even if the negative charge is trying to go back, there is no path available.
Yes, sir.
Correct.
Understood.
Correct. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yes. So charging by induction can be temporary and it can be permanent also. Remember this. Okay. Good. So this is charging by induction. Next comes charging by conduction. So let us talk about that. Charging by conduction. Now this charging by conduction method is used in conductors. It is the method of charging. It is the method of charging used in conductors. Okay. Why? Because this is charging by conduction. So as it is charging by conduction, it can only be used in conductors. Now question arises is, what are conductors? So we have talked a little bit about conductors in the chapter of heat transfer. If you remember, we have talked a little about conductors in the chapter of heat transfer. So what are the conductors? Which substances are called conductors? So conductors are the substances readily allow flow charge/current through them. Please note, conductors are the substances which readily allow flow of charge/current through them. Okay. So conductors are the substances which readily allow flow of charge or current through them. Okay. Now, why any substance behaves as conductor? It is due to the availability of free electrons. A substance can behave as conductor. A substance can behave as conductor due to availability of free electrons. Due to availability of free electrons. Okay. So a substance can behave as conductor due to availability of free electrons. Okay. Now, what are free electrons? That is another thing. So free electrons, basically these phenomena of free electrons is typical for the conductors. Okay. There are certain electrons which are participating in bonding. And there are certain electrons which are not participating in any kind of bonding, and those are freely available to move throughout the conductor. Such electrons are called free electrons. So please note, free electrons. Free electrons are the electrons which can flow or which can move freely within the conductors. Okay. Free electrons are the electrons which can move freely within the conductors. Now remember, there are three type of substances. One are called conductor, second are called insulator, and third are called safe. Okay, we'll be talking about it later also. So conductors are the substances which allow readily flow of electrons. Insulators are the substances which do not allow flow of current or electrons because they don't have free electrons. For example, if you take wood, so wood don't have free electrons. So if you are holding a wooden stick and if you touch any wire of current, you won't. Why? Because wood is not a good conductor. But in place of wood, if you have a metal rod and if you go and touch that wire, you will get a divine experience. Okay, your eyes will be more bright, some fumes will also be coming out of ears, your hairs will be straightened. All these experience you can get if you are holding a metallic rod and you are going to touch a wire in which current is flowing. Such things are not advised, but if you want to do, then you do it on your own risk. Okay, all right. But similarly, if you have as I told you, if you have a wooden rod and if you go and touch flowing with the help of wooden rod, you won't be getting any divine experience. It will be a simple, normal, usual thing for you. So it is good to have non-conductors also or insulators also. Okay, semiconductors are different type of substances. We'll be talking about it later. All right, so what happens in charging by conductors? Let us see. So suppose we have one sphere. All right, so we have one, this is positively charged. And we have another sphere which is, let's say, negatively charged. Okay, if you have not connected the both are metallics. Metallic sphere. Metallic sphere. So if you don't connect them by any wire or any substance, then charge will not go from one object to another. Charge cannot jump through free space. It requires a medium to travel. So what you need to do is basically you need to connect them by metallic wire. So if you are connecting it by metallic wire, then charge will flow from one object to another. From one object to another. Okay. This kind of flow of charge. Flow means transfer also, remember, huh? This kind of flow of charge is called charging by conduction. Okay, by this method, by charging by conduction, you can give any amount of to an object. By conduction method, we can give any amount of charge, to an object. Okay. So by conduction, you can give any amount of charge to an object. Please note. Please note.
So how can we give any amount of charge to the object?
Water which is in a tank, okay, and if you want to fill it in 20, 50, 40 buckets, can you fill it in 40, 50 buckets?
So
yes, no.
So could you please repeat? So your voice was cracked.
My question is that if you have water in a big tank and if you want to fill 20, 40, 50 buckets from it, can you fill it in 20, 40, 50 buckets?
No, sir.
No?
So means depends
on big from a big from a big tank, you cannot fill 40, 50 buckets?
So it depends on how big the tank is.
I am already saying it is a big tank. So big then, means big.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so same way if you have big amount of charge and if you have a wire, if you have a pipeline, can you give charge to small objects?
Yes, sir.
If you want to experience through your electric connection, no? Consider yourself as an object. Go and touch the wire. See how much charge you can get. Hello?
Sir, I understood like the concept. Sir, no, sir.
Experience? No?
No.
No, believe me, you can get any amount of charge. Okay? If you go and touch the wire, you will get very good amount of charge. All right? Just leave it when the time is appropriate. After that, sorry, Babu. Okay. So the point is, by conduction, you can give any amount of charge, that is for sure. You should have the charge, and if you have it, you can. All right. Any doubt, any question, anyone? Please feel free to ask. Do not hesitate. All right. Okay. So, let us move further. So basically, we have talked so far about charges, then the properties of charges, then how charging is done. Now the next part which comes is Coulomb's law, which is actually the thing about which you can ask numerical questions. So Coulomb's law. So Coulomb was a scientist who gave a law to find force between two point charges. So Coulomb, please note, gave a law to find electrostatic force between two point charges. Okay, and what was the value of the point charge or force? Pay attention. So suppose this is Q1 and this is Q2. These are the two point charges and these are kept at separation R. Okay. And if F is the force acting between the two charges. So F is proportional to Q1 into Q2. So force between the two point charges is for the product of the two charges. Okay. The force between the two charges is also inversely proportional of square of distance between the two charges. What does it mean? That means if charges are kept nearby, force will be more. If charges are kept far away, force will be less. Okay. So if you club these two together, you get F is proportional to Q1, Q2 upon R square. And if you remove the proportionality, you get F is equal to K Q1, Q2 upon R square. Okay. You get F is equal to K Q1, Q2 upon R square. What is K here? Here, K is equal to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught. The value of upon 4 pi epsilon naught, and that value is 9 into 10 to the power 9 in SI unit. In SI unit, that value is 9 into 10 to the power 9. Okay. In CGS unit, that value is 1. Remember that. CGS unit, that value is 1. Now, what is epsilon naught? So epsilon naught is called permittivity of. Epsilon naught is called permittivity of. Free space. Okay. And value of epsilon naught is 8.85 into 10 to the power minus 12 Newton meter square upon Coulomb square. Okay. That is the value of epsilon naught. Remember this value because this value is also important. All right. So what is epsilon naught? It is called permittivity of free space. Epsilon naught is permittivity of free space. Okay. Now let me give you one simple question so that you can solve it. So there is a charge of Coulomb, and this is half Coulomb. This separation is 2 meters. Find force between the two charges. Find force in the two charges. Question is very easy. You will get the answer quickly. Please give me the answer.
Okay, everyone, pay attention. F will be K Q1 upon K is 9 into 10 to the power 9. Q1 is 2. Q2 is half upon 2 square. So 9 upon 4 is 2.25 into 10 to the power 9 newtons. This is the answer. This is the answer. Most of you have got it correctly. That is good. The next part of the question is, which is basically the next question, find minimum value of electrostatic force. Find minimum value of electrostatic force acting between two charges kept at 1 meter separation. Okay, please find. Yes, it's saying 2.304 into 10 to the power minus 27. Then Lisa is saying 10 to the power minus 30. Ibial is saying 10 to the power minus 27. Ayush is saying 23.04 into 10 to the power minus 29.
Let us see. So this is Q1, this is Q2, the separation is 1 meter, and F is to will be K Q1 upon 1 square, K is 9 into 10 to the power 9. Now, question says that the minimum value of force
A minimum value of force will be when charge is minimum, and minimum charge can be 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 into 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 upon 1 square is anyway 1. So that becomes 9 into 1.6 into 1.6. 1.6 into 1.6 is 2.56 into 9 is 23.04 into 10 to the power minus 19 into 10 to the power minus 19 becomes 10 to the power minus 38 into minus 9 is 10 to the power minus 29. Okay. So that can be written as 2.30 into 10 to the power minus 20. This is the answer which we are getting today. This is the answer which we are getting right now. How many of you are getting this answer? How many of you are getting this answer? All right, so that is enough for today. We'll study further in the next class. All right, everyone. Thank you so much. Keep studying, keep solving questions.
So shouldn't it be 30?
Why it should be 30? 19 plus 19 is minus 38. Minus 38, minus 9 will be minus 29.
So no, 10 is to minus 30, right?
Why 10 raised to minus 30?
So I mean, you're shifting the decimal, so.
Yeah, so if you are shifting the decimal, then the power should be reduced because it is minus power. Which one is bigger, 10 to the power minus 29 or 10 to the power minus 30?
So, okay, so got it.
Good. Okay, everyone, thank you so much.